Good evening. My name is Dimitris Valatsas, a freshman at Harvard College, and it is my honor to welcome you to the John F. Kennedy Junior Forum. As a Greek national, I would like to give you a perspective of what Ms. Angelopoulou has done for Greece, the country, as well as the people, not from a strictly organizational, her success in that field is well appreciated, but from a more human point of view. The bidding and organization of the 2004 Olympic Games was for Greece, the smallest country ever to organize the game, both a dream and a challenge, resulting from the desire to achieve on the world stage to host the event that is most closely related to her history. Not without controversy, Ms. Angelopoulou Daskalaki was the face of the program from the bidding until the successful completion of the game. Challenged by many, respected by all, her leadership brought the games to every Greek household and turned the Olympic dream into a shared ambition. In that spirit, the students of Harvard University welcome her today, wishing that the forum provides an opportunity for all the attendees to learn how to turn a dream into a task and an organization into a common endeavor. To introduce Ms. Angelopoulou Daskalaki, please welcome the Dean of the John F. Kennedy School of Government, David Elwood.
Thank you, Dimitri. This is a wonderful evening. It's actually capping off several wonderful evenings. But before I introduce our very special guest, I do want to welcome the several people. His Eminence Archbishop Dimitrios is here in the audience. Very much you're welcome here. And many of you may or may not know, he is also a graduate of this institution, doctorate here at Harvard. And His Eminence Metropolitan Methodios is also here. And welcome. It's our great honor to have you here with us. The address this evening is entitled "The Athens Games Resolving the Paradox, the Greek Paradox." What many of you may not know is that this represents a coming of full circle of a set of events that began about 10 years ago here at the Kennedy School. At that time, with the support and ideas of our guest tonight, we put together a forum, a set of events looking at the Greek paradox. And as a result of that, a book came out summarizing the events. And the book, in the preface to the book, The Greek Paradox, co-authored by our guest tonight and Graham T. Allison, also here with us, they wrote the following: "The birthplace of democracy finds itself with a government that is often paralyzed. How can this be? How can this be overcome? Economically, in entrepreneurship, finance, shipping, and business, individual Greeks push the frontiers of the global economy. But Greece itself lags behind other member countries in the European Union. Why? And what can be done to accelerate Greece's economic performance?" My guess is that very few people in the audience that day that participated in it recognized that our guest, who was a sponsor of the event, would in fact be herself the answer to the Greek paradox. That she would almost single-handedly, though she would be quick to point out, with many, many, many other partners, move Greece through the Olympics and many other things to a remarkable statement. Yana Angelopoulos Daskalaki brought the Olympic Games to Greece, and she's preserved the host status for Athens and presided over what the Financial Times called one of the greatest feats of 2004. I think they were being modest. It was one of the greatest feats for a country of the Greek size in the entire century. This feat was, of course, not the first of her many great accomplishments. She was born in Crete, where her father worked in the food industry. She left the island to study at the Aristotelian University of Thessaloniki, earning a first-class law degree. Upon graduation, she was admitted to the Athens Bar, and she was a practicing member of a respected law firm. Mrs. Angelopoulos Daskalaki entered the political arena, and this was the first of many, perhaps the second, because probably school was part of that as well, examples where she was expected to fail. There was no chance of winning this election, but of course, she didn't believe it. And indeed, she won the election, winning a seat on Athens Municipal Council. And hers was a very innovative campaign. And despite the lack of political backing and so forth, she won her race. And in 1989, as a candidate for the New Democratic Party, Democracy Party, She won elections to the Greek Parliament from Athens' first region, and she was reelected the following year. In 1990, Mrs. Angelopoulos Daskalaki married Theodore Angelopoulos and resigned her seat, immersing herself in the family's international shipping business. She is, in addition to Greek, she's fluent, by the way, in English, French, Italian, and German. And then in 1994, the most important thing happened from our perspective. She accepted the appointment as vice chair of the Dean's Council at the Kennedy School in 1994. But far more important, of course, was what happened in 1996. She accepted the opportunity to lead Greece's crusade to host the 2004 Olympic Games. As bid president, Mrs. Angelopoulos Daskalaki united the nation behind the effort. For 2 years, she worked tirelessly to persuade the IOC that Greece possessed the competence, the facilities, the infrastructure, and the athletic environment to host the best ever Olympics. She won that bid, or they won that bid, but it wasn't long before the naysayers looked like they might be right. For several years, 2 or 3 years, little seemed to be happening, and suddenly she was called forth to help put the games back on track. In the interim, she had been named ambassador at large in 1998. So, in 2000, she became the head of the Olympic Organizing Committee, the president. What's striking, though, is once again, everybody said, it couldn't be done, it wouldn't be done. Disaster after disaster was predicted. I don't know if any of you remember these newspaper stories, even up to a week before the Olympics. There was talk about how it would fail, how nothing would go right, well, there'd be massive traffic jams and so forth. And indeed, what happened was one of the greatest games in Olympic history. IOC President Jacques Rogge called it an unforgettable dream games. But even more impressive in some respects, the press admitted they had been wrong. The New York Times had an editorial said, Olympic disasters are a no-show. And they said, hats off to Greece for running a Summer Olympics that defied all the dire predictions. And it goes on to say, Greece should become the permanent home of the Olympics, or at least they made a very strong case to that effect. CNN.com is reported to have said, we apologize, we made a mistake, we've been after them for the whole time, and it was spectacular. It was a magnificent event. But you know, in many ways, those who know the ambassador will understand completely why this happened. Let me just tell you one anecdote which she told me, I hope it's all right to tell, that summarizes and indicates the kind of woman, the kind of person she is. She talked about during the Olympics, there were contingencies for everything. So they'd have contingency plan A, contingency plan B, contingency plan C. So if anything went wrong, if there was any problem or whatever, they had something worked out for it. But there was clearly one kind of contingency she wasn't ready for. And the story actually occurs in the evening, I guess, before they were making the presentation for the US, for the Olympic bid in Athens. I'm sorry? In Lisarne, that's right. The bid for Athens in Lisarne, thank you. One of the consultants that was hired to help the committee help with the winning bid came in and brought some talking points. There was one set of talking points in case they won, and another set of talking points in case they lost. Well, with fire in her eyes, she said, what do you think I am, a loser? We are going to win. You ruined my day. This is outrageous. Get out of my office. Failure was not an option. And failure did not occur. On item after item, it was a remarkable example of success. And in recognition of her Olympian accomplishments as president of the Athens 2004 Organizing Committee, the Greek president awarded Mrs. Angelopoulos Daskalaki, the prestigious Commander of the Order of Honor, Commander of the Order of Honor Medal in 2004. Please join me in welcoming a great friend of Greece, a great friend of Harvard, and a great friend of the world, Ambassador Yana Angelopoulos Daskalaki.
Madison Wilson? Madison Wilson? Oh, yes. Thank you. It's very kind.
This
Good evening.
Would never have happened in the Olympics. The water would not have been ready.
Thank you, Dean. Good evening, and thank you. The story of the Athens Games and their importance to Greece is too complex to tell in its entirety tonight. How can I describe a seven-year story in just one single speech? But it is a story that needs to be told, and I believe that Harvard is the perfect place to begin telling it. I remember coming to Harvard in 1994. I've seen New England for the first time then, and I was wondering how I can contribute to this special place. Then, as now, my angel, Holly Sargent, was there. And she was the one that made me feel at home. And she helped me, and she supported me in becoming a part of this community. Holly, thank you so much for your help and for everything you have done. And thank you for trying so hard to make this trip a success. In ancient times, the Olympic Games emerged as a powerful symbol of Greece's golden age. Wars were halted for the duration of the Games. The Games inspired artists and poets. They filled some of the antiquity's greatest treasures with wrestlers, with runners, and the athletes themselves were inspired, their performances pushing the limits of the human body and spirit. 2,500 years later, the Games became a modern symbol of the vibrant, sophisticated new Greece that I see emerging, a capable, cosmopolitan nation, ready to play a larger role in the region and in the world. But my team and I, those of us who won and organized the Games, wanted even more. We asked not just that they become a symbol of change, but actually become a driver of change. We wanted the Games to unify the people of Greece, to instill within us a new sense of pride, to push our economy ahead, and to make our capital city a more beautiful and livable place. We asked that these Games resolve once and for all what I called the Greek paradox. Everybody knows all over the world, Greek Americans, Greek Canadians, Greek Australians, and others in the diaspora have built names for themselves. They are intelligent, they are capable people, successful in every field. Greece itself is one of the world's great shipping industries, talented politicians, and an academic tradition that predates the Platos Academy. But for many years, Greece was a laggard nation. Despite our success as individuals at home or far from home, the Greek nation was poor, the political institutions were often unreliable, and the regional influence was small. Graham Allison and I labeled this disconnect between promise and performance the Greek paradox. We invited scholars to analyze this and to prescribe political and economic cures that would bring this paradox to an end. And we heard extraordinary insights and ideas. The result was a study that offered an articulate and insightful look at post-World War II Greece. But I believed that an appeal to logic and reform to the Apollonian side of the Greek psyche, psyche, as we say in Greek, would never be enough to end centuries of economic tribalism, political dysfunction, and structural inefficiency. I knew that reform of the famously passionate, proud, and creative Greek people had to come from the heart as well as from the mind, that we needed Dionysus as well. The Olympic Games would be a way to unite the two sides of Greek society, Apollo and Dionysus. The pressures of preparations would force the politicians and bureaucrats to find a way to make our government work. The fast side of the undertaking would force us to work together. The pressure of a global countdown would bring out our best. And the pride aroused by the games would unite us as never before. It was a lot to ask from 19 days of sports. Some might call it a gamble that Greece came painfully close to losing. But 13 months after the games, I can say this. I believed from the beginning that the people of Greece could overcome any obstacle and handle any responsibility, no matter how important, complex, or large. That faith in the people of Greece was rewarded gloriously and repeatedly, of course, by the success of the Athens Games. Their work on the Olympics Games, on the Olympics, left Greece with a stronger economy and 21st century infrastructure, a renewed national pride, and the greater respect of the world. The paradox has now become a challenge, one every nation would be fortunate to have, the challenge of maintaining and growing Greek success. To win the games and to host them successfully, we would have to bury the Greek paradox once and for all. We would have to look toward the future and not just celebrate our past. We would have to look toward the future again to overcome bureaucracy, to overcome politics, and make the government a vehicle for progress, not just for patronage and obstruction. We would have to create a culture of active involvement, work hard, work for many years, work together all the time, believing in our ability to succeed. The obstacle was to overcome the self-doubt that lingered like scar tissue in some quarters in the wake of the failed effort to host the 1996 Centennial Games. Greece failed in 1990. Why? Because we were arrogant in the assumption that we had a right to host the Games in Athens on the 100th anniversary of their rebirth. Greece failed because our critics thought us too poor, too disorganized, too Mediterranean. They thought that we simply couldn't be trusted to host such an important world-class sport event. So, in 1997, when we bid again, our approach is different. It was based on merit, and it contained a new strategic design. At its core, it were economic, logistical, environmental benefits that would touch every Greek and meet the concerns of the selection committee. But at its heart, it was a strong appeal to Greek unity and pride. We reminded Greece that it was time to kill off the lingering stereotypes. We showed the International Olympic Committee that we were no longer a nation only of marble and bronze, but one of steel and silicon. And something remarkable happened. The Greece of old would have been overwhelmed by our initial defeat, walking away in disappointment. But not the new Greece. When we reached Lausanne for the final vote, we had behind us the support of 96% of Greek people. All the political parties, the prime minister and the opposition, and the mayor of Athens. With a united Greece behind us, determined to host a 21st century games, we could confidently promise the IOC that Athens would be great for the athletes and Greece would be great for the games. A phrase that would become our mantra and later the measure of our success. We would provide athletes who embody the Olympic ideal and who teach all of us the power of the human spirit with state-of-the-art facilities and with passionate cheering and support, inspiring them to perform at their exquisite best. And for the Games, we would make Greece itself a lesson in the history and ideals that define the greatest sporting tradition. We would put today's performance in a context that added depth and understanding to the fans' experience. We would make Greece a lesson in Olympism, that 4 billion people would see that. The backdrop for this competition would be an Athens that had pulled itself into the 21st century, almost as though it had skipped the last 30 years. A single-century-old subway line built to serve a city about 180,000 people would be supplemented by two modern subway lines, light rail, suburban train. Together, they would have the capacity to carry 1 million people per day. Limited access highways would finally be built, carrying cars rapidly and now Athens' legendary traffic, while downtown roads were widened and intersections streamlined. Electrical information communications networks would be modernized and their capacity dramatically increased. And the entire city, public and private sectors, would embark on a campaign to clean and beautify itself. Some of these projects, they were already underway, but obstructive bureaucracies, parochial politicians, inefficient constructors needed to pressure off a deadline to get things done. Bureaucracies in Greece and anywhere don't reform themselves. The Olympic Games would become the anvil against which we hammered them into a more modern shape. Back in 1997, our global campaign culminated in IOC headquarters in Lausanne, where in the fourth round of voting, we beat Buenos Aires, Stockholm, Cape Town, Rome, and Athens won the right to stage the Games. There were dancing in the streets of Athens, in the hotels in Lausanne, but already I was worried. Even amidst dancing and champagne, I was worried that 7 years preparation would not be enough time. Ironically, 7 years now seems an unimaginable luxury, because in the end we didn't have 7 years. Another team was elected to head the Athens 2004 Organizing Committee, ATHOC as it is known. They spent 3 years failing to follow through on the outline we had drawn. Reforms were not pressed, work was not done, and the spirit of unity forged during the bid was not harnessed and put to work. We would pay dearly for these 3 lost years. By the time the IOC president Samaranch issued his famous yellow card threatening to take the Games away from Athens, by the time my team and I came back, just 4 years remained. Look, it may be hard for Americans to understand why the Games would mean so much to Greece, to bring so much risk. You may remember Los Angeles hosted the Games in 1984. In the entire nation of Greece, there are fewer people than the LA metropolitan area. Back then, they had 221 events, 6,800 athletes, 9,800 credentialed journalists. By Athens, the Games had grown significantly bigger, 301 events, 10,500 athletes, 21,000 journalists. As for the preparations, let me set an example. Imagine Boston constructing 2 brand new T lines under downtown, 2 light rail lines into the suburbs, undertaking the big dig, building or widening more than 100 miles of road, completely renovating Storrow Drive, if I say it, trying to maneuver 17,000 ton roof over the top of Fenway Park, and that and much more were our challenge. We began to catch up almost immediately, but my Greek paradox was not the only Greek paradox on my mind during these endless, frenzied days. The ancient Greek thinker Zeno or Zenon, as we say, proposed a paradox showing that the great hero Achilles cannot beat a tortoise in the foot race if he gives the tortoise a lead. By the time Achilles reaches the point in which the tortoise began to race, the tortoise has moved to point B. By the time Achilles reaches point B, the tortoise is at point C. And so on, with Achilles always behind, if only by an infinitely small amount. As Athok and Greece strained to do 7 years' work in 4 years' time, I sometimes felt that we were running the same exactly race, and that our deadlines had an unsurmountable head start. By the time benchmarks set for 2000 were passed, it was already 2002. By the time we completed tasks slated for 2002, it was 2003, and every day we ran the gap, we cut the gap a little more, and every day we wondered if the time lost would be too much time to make up. The achievements came slowly at first, but the pace accelerated rapidly. Athens Airport, Europe's most modern and secure airport, opened for business. New subway stations came online one by one. Politicians, ministries, city councils were forced to respond to real needs, not internal procedures. Ground was broken on the remaining venues, roadwork moved into high gear, the tram and the suburban railway routes were graded, the government, private contractors, and most important, the people of Greece began to work together with a confidence and a shared vision none of us had ever seen before. Our unity extended even to our neighbors and allies. As we worked together to construct a seamless security zone for the first Summer Olympic Games after 9/11. We shared intelligence and expertise and embarked on an unprecedented series of security maneuvers. Greece committed to €1 billion security budget. We brought in experts and technology from all over the world. We arrested, tried, and imprisoned more than a dozen individual members of domestic terror organizations. As the pressure grew, we Greeks rolled up our sleeves and worked even harder, and in Athens, a 21st century Olympic city began to emerge. This race continued up until the very last minute. Tram and light rail, they opened just days prior to the Olympics, and on August 13, 2004, Achilles finally caught the tortoise. During the opening ceremony, the world saw that we had indeed completed 7 years of work in 4 years' time. After 108 years, the Olympics had come home. A mesmerizing opening ceremony was followed by 90 days of magnificent competition. Cyclists raced in the shadow of Parthenon. Runners followed the route when the messenger brought news to Athens that they had a triumph. Persia was defeated after the Battle of Marathon. Archers competed in Panathinaiko Stadium, the first modern stadium where the 1896 Games were hosted. For the first time in almost two millennia, athletes competed in the stadium in Olympia. For the first time in history, women athletes competed in Olympia as well. 45,000 volunteers gave directions to visitors, they translated signs, they checked passes, they placed hurdles, and this on the track of the soaring Olympic Stadium. The subway ran all night. So did the celebrations in Plaka, in the neighborhoods. Greek athletes were winning medal after medal. I could talk for hours about the brilliance and the history and the emotion that the athletes and the fans brought to the Athens Games, but I'd rather let you see again, so we'll brought a video for your pleasure. Thank you.
being able to be part of such an exciting event and such a great Olympics is an honor.
I think everything has been up to par here in the village and at the stadium. Thank you for having me, and I want to come back.
great for the athletes. And Greece was great for the games.
These games were unforgettable dream games.
Hope to see you again.
Καλή ενδάμωση.
Now, as Athens works with the Beijing organizers to transfer our knowledge and our experience, we can look back on our own effort and say that the Athens Games were a tremendous success. We had record attendance, we had record performances, TV ratings were superb, accommodations and transport systems work flawlessly, as did our technology and reporting systems. We held the first ever global torch relay. The games were secure. Fans, Greeks, and visitors from around the world had a wonderful time, whether they were watching cyclists at the velodrome or dining beneath the Acropolis. We truly celebrated the Olympic Games in every sense of the word. Bringing the word what the IOC President Jacques Roch called an unforgettable dream games. Yes, Athens had delivered for the Olympic movement, great for the athletes, great for the games. But had the games delivered for Greece? We promised the people of Athens that the Athens Games would unify the nation, push the economy ahead, and show the new Greece to the world. And I believed they did. Our transport system was transformed, our traffic is better, our air is cleaner, it has been, but it has been in decades. Urban wasteland along the coast has been reclaimed for parkland and athletic facilities and made accessible to downtown by public transport. From new lighting to the Acropolis, to the thousands of buildings renovated and repainted, to the billboards that they have disappeared, Athens is a more beautiful city. The great cooperation made all this happen has unearthed a civic spirit that will continue making our city a more beautiful, more gracious place to live. The effect on the Greek economy has been undeniably positive. Infrastructure improvements have transformed Greece, not just the transformed communications infrastructure, but also the human infrastructure. 100,000 Greeks received technical and games-related training during preparations, a tremendous investment in a workforce of just 5 million people. Many of them worked for years on cutting-edge, high-pressure projects, including engineering, construction, communications, security. We have proved that there is no project so complicated that Greece cannot support it. The Greek economy, powered by Olympic preparations, grew at multiples of the European Union rate in the years leading up to the Games, and that momentum continues. 100,000 jobs were created in Greece for the Games, and in aftermath of the Games, employment has continued to rise. This is due in part of the significant 15% jump in tourism this year, 20% in Athens only. Americans, as opposed to Europeans who were more aware of our attractions before the Games, make up a high percentage of this increase. And this is a testament of effectiveness of our exposure during the Games. And the Olympic Games were a 19-day advertisement for our competence and sophistication. Potential investors discovered that Greece has the talent, the attitude, the infrastructure, and the EU membership needed to compete in Europe, the Balkans, and the Middle East. But the Games were not without tremendous costs. Every project of this size experienced cost overruns, but ours were exceptional. The 3 years wasted between 1997 and my team's return in 2000 resulted in overtime wages, sometimes extravagant construction costs. Security concerns after 9/11 added immensely to our security budget. Post-Olympic use of venues constructed for the Games remains a problem as well. We conceived these venues as mixed-use and community-based facilities. The government, which had neither planned for nor acquired the legal authority for post-Games usage, now has the authority and is working to resolve the problem. As government and private businesses look more closely at the original plans, and better understand their potential uses, most of them will become valuable, self-sustaining resources for the region. The people of Greece are paying more now than they should have to pay for the pride, growth, and respect that they are their Olympic legacy. But I believe, in pure economic terms, the Games paid off for Greece. And I believe an even greater payoff has been the intangible returns we realized in the wake of our success. Personally, I'm most inspired the way Greeks worked of every background. They came together in pursuit of a single goal. 160,000 people applied to volunteer for the Olympic Games. Hundreds of thousands more cheered athletes from every nation on. Ministers and bureaucrats put partisanship and process aside and made the Games their first priority. Workers and construction laborers around the clock worked around the clock to build venues and staff the Games. This unprecedented unit in the face of extraordinary pressure is the surest proof yet that the Greek paradox is rapidly becoming a relic of an earlier age. But unlike so many antiquities in Greece, we don't want this one to be preserved. In 1995, after the conclusion of the Symposium of the Greek Paradox, the remarks and papers of its participants were edited into a book from Graham Allison and Kalypso Nikolaidis, who wrote in the introduction, and I quote, "But ultimately, what needs to be questioned in Greece is as much the state of mind as the state of things. Participants in this project called for a shift from an attitude of entitlement to a spirit of participation, from a focus on Greek rights to a spirit of Greek interests, and from a defensive posture to a proactive approach in its relationship with neighbors and allies," end quote. Ladies and gentlemen, attitudes take time to alter. Habits built often generations cannot be overcome in 7 years' time. But as ATHOC president, I saw the Olympic spirit drive the shift to which Nikolaidis refers. Even at the moment of crisis, when we could have lost the Games, we overcame the urge to retreat into faction, into apathy, and we worked together relentlessly and successfully. I saw a growing understanding that we rise and fall together, not as families or as regions, but as Greeks. I saw emerging a new confidence and talent in the way we dealt with the world. We transformed the way the world sees us and the way we see one another. And perhaps this is the most important gain of all. Today, a year later, that same spirit that carried us to success survives, hastening the Greek paradox towards resolution and making the new Greece both an emblem of and a product of the power of the Olympic Games. Dean Elwood, thank you. I thank you, all of you.
That was truly wonderful, and there were I at least had some tears during those Olympic scenes, so it's quite remarkable. We have time for some questions. There are microphones in four locations, one right here, one just above here, another, a third one here, a fourth one here. And so I'd just like to remind people our ground rules for questions. First of all, we ask that you introduce yourself. Second of all, a good question has several characteristics. One, there is only one question. Two, it ends with a question mark. And so with that, let's open up for questions. There's one right up here.
Hello, I'm from, my name is Gregory Dimitriadis. I'm from the Fletcher School. So that's kind of strange to have the first question at Harvard. Obviously we're coming here because we like the university here as well. And my question will be, well, first of all, wow, it was a very nice video. And for somebody who has lived 8 years out of Greece before the games were spectacular. Athens was so different. And I would like also to mention that it was very interesting for me that there were no advertisements of sponsors in all the venues. And that was very interesting. Now, the question for the question mark, I would say that it will be, how can we overcome the paradox now that back in Greece there are many people who still complain about the cost and all this thing, and if it's really worth to have the games, and how can we be able to continue this momentum, be maybe Athens and New Barcelona, and you as a leader with who faces challenges, how you think will be your role maybe in the future of this? Thank you.
Actually, there were three questions.
But it ended with a question mark.
Yeah, okay. Okay, an easy answer should be, let's do the games again, actually. The Greek paradox is not there anymore. And there is a proof, because the way we worked, the way we brought the success, the way we forgot our bad ourselves and put out our best angels, is the way that the Greek paradox is not there. As for the Greeks, it's up to Greeks and their leadership to keep up the good things that they came out of the games. And what is important is to remember for them what they have done, what they have achieved. In 19 days, they surpassed every civilized, wealthy, strong country around the world. They've done it. They've done it in 4 year times instead of seven. And there is so much infrastructure there, especially the human one, that this is not lost. It is there. And as for me, you know, I'm an open-minded person. There are people that they bring the opportunities in front of me, and I sense them sometimes. So what can I say? Nobody can foresee the future, but everybody can be open to changes that he or she can make, to things that he or she can change. And that's the wonderful thing about being useful, being active in society.
Right over here.
Yes, good evening. My name is Renoël Ferrobrac. I am a mid-career MPA here at the Kennedy School, and I am French. Would you have any recommendation for France to someday win the Olympic Games?
It's never too late, my friend. C'est jamais trop tard, comme on dit en français. It's never too late. Actually, I believe, because it's a lot of speculation and discussion about where the games are to go next time. And there were some people that very enthusiastic, they say, let the games be always in Greece. Oh my God, can you imagine what I have some more years? Or in Olympia. But when the games, they were revived by your Pierre de Coubertin and our Vikelas, the intention it was the games to go around the world and bring their light to different countries and take from each country's richness and culture and heritage. And this is the right thing to do. And to be even bolder, I should say that the games, they should, why not to go to all continents? Why not to Africa? Why not to South America? And of course, they are beautiful cities, but you know, there is no city who is the same before the games and after the games. Paris is a wonderful city, there is no doubt about. And I believe that there is always a timing and there is always a chance to do things the way we want.
Question right up there.
Hi, my name is Fagazi. I'm from South Africa. And I wanted to know, as it is, South Africa will be hosting a very similar big event in 2010. And we're really facing a whole negative in terms of media management and other stakeholders. What advice you would give to our people back in South Africa?
Ignore them. Do your job the best way you can. Judge yourselves with the most objective criteria. And remember that the days they will come, you will perform, and this is your answer to everybody.
Gianna, I'm Graham Allison, a friend of Gianna's for a long time and a professor here. The story you tell is an inspiring story, and it's actually, I watched the Olympics, but nonetheless, you just can't help but get excited by it. But there must have been some moments in this process in which you had some doubts or some worries that you were going to succeed. So it can't be that you were just so certain you were going to be successful that never were you worried. Can you tell us about a time or two when you were thinking, whoa, maybe this is not going to work out quite as well as we hoped?
Yes, I am frank and open, yes. Sometimes came that I was not sure if we can do it. But not the Greek people. It was, let me say, the practices that they were being followed around us. And as I say, sometimes politics make things not better, but they jeopardize things. And I knew that the time is ticking out, and we had, I mean, we didn't have 7 years, we had 4 years, and then, I mean, 3 years, and it was then some months. But I never doubted about the ability of Greek people, because what we met during the process, it was people, talented people, people with very important CVs, but also people, they are all around, all levels of famine and all parts of the society, that first of all, they were decisive about what they can do, and then they wanted all the same goal so much. And I don't speak about only the organizing committee, that games time we had 11,500 people working for that. I speak about the volunteers, I speak about the people that were working in the public sector, the private sector. Sometimes I'm going many times to supervise the construction, you know, and I will see workers and say, I mean, Jana or President or Ms. Angelopoulos, you know, we'll do it, we'll give them the answer. Everybody was, how we say, I mean, up to the task. And then the people, the society, people that they were to buy their tickets, people that they were so disciplined. I would never believe that people in Greece, they were so disciplined. Nobody dared to turn on a cigarette in the stadiums because we were games without smoking. Nobody dared to say, no, I want to have my private car because I'm a Greek, nobody can give me instructions. They followed, you know, the procedure. We informed them well. We respected the Greek people, and they responded the best way. our volunteers. I mean, people of Athens, people they had to run different hours of walk and so on. So these are the opposite side, the time that I was desperate sometimes and down, it was immediately a response that was coming from somewhere that made me say, I believe we can do it. They can do it. I was one among them. They wanted all so much this to succeed that this really kept me strong. And I don't regret it, of course. Thank you.
Right over here.
Hello, Eleni Andriadis from Thessaloniki, Greece, a second year graduate student here. My question is, why do you think that the media was so hostile to and so skeptical of the Greek preparations, sometimes even going to great lengths to prove to prove that we weren't going to make it, having sort of people going in as spies, especially the British, I remember a British case. So my question is, you know, why do you think that they were so hostile?
Because media is media. Everybody knows. I mean, sometimes I was the most objective. I knew that we could give them the answer, games time, and we did. And they, all of them apologized. They say sorry, they wrote it, they show it in many ways. But you know, before a miracle will happen, nobody believes that a miracle will happen. So they are coming to Greece, I mean, 1.5 years prior to the games, they were seen, I mean, the stadium, I mean, still without roof and so. So they had doubts. I say, a normal country can never do it. And actually, Greece is not a normal country by their standards. It's an extraordinary country. And these people, they have no limits when they want for good. So that's the answer. We gave them the answer that they deserved.
Right up here.
Hi. My name is Dimitris Kyridis. I am the Karamanlis Professor of International Relations at the Fletcher School. And I was here 10 years ago to the day in October 95 when we discussed the Greek paradox. And I was also in the stadium, in the Olympic Stadium on August the 13th of 2004 in this amazing opening ceremony. And I think I will share everybody's feeling to tell you a very great thank you for making us all very, very proud. You've been an amazing inspiration to us all for the amazing job you've done. This is a school that studies and teaches leadership. And being this the case, I wonder what are the skills, what are the qualities with this challenge that you were confronted with that you are to identify for the students and the scholars here of leadership as the paramount leadership qualities that helped you carry the day. Thank you.
Actually, I didn't know if I have leadership qualities. What I've been through showed that it's very important for people to have a goal in life, or even to let the others pull them for a reason, for a nobler reason, for make better our lives, for achieve something. So you need a goal, and you need to stick to the goal and plan for that. We had plans. Actually, we had so many plans. We had plan A and plan B and plan C. If something happens, we can turn it around this way and have a plan and ask from people, give the example, I believe, to be hardworking, disciplined, and to the job, and show them that you never give up. And allow me to say that in Greece, I mean, people, they need to know that you have to be after them. So people, they showed a unique spirit of actually they wanted to show that they can work well, and they liked to be in teams. I mean, something that first time happened in Greece, I mean, be team workers or be disciplined and work around the clock and never check about the clock. But they knew that it was such an emergency. And I believe that also controlling the system, it's very important. So it's hard work, it's having a goal, It's never give up. It's been an inspiration, an example for the others. I mean, you cannot just ask the others work if you go once a week in the office and you stay for a couple of hours and you give an interview and then back. No, no. You have to be with them. So for Greece, this worked, actually.
So I'll have to be the last question.
Madam Ambassador, Nick Larigakis, Executive Director with the American Hellenic Institute in Washington, D.C. I was one of the proud and privileged volunteers at the Games, and although there's no reason for you to remember, you and I sat next to each other during the tremendous victory by Mr. Tabakos on the rings that evening in Athens. Is an emotional event that I will never forget. But very quickly, if I may, volunteers were a very important aspect of this game. Greece was being criticized if, in fact, volunteers would come out, because it's not part of the Greek psyche to do this. Very quickly, has that been left behind now as a legacy within Greek society to, you know, for people to volunteer more in general? And another very quick question, another miracle happened prior to those games, and that was Greece winning the European Championship in soccer. Can you tell us briefly, what did that mean for you and your people 6 weeks prior to the games to have something like that vault you into the beginning of the games?
That was an encouragement, that was a boost, and that was also a sense of pride that came for us these last days prior to the Olympics. And we knew already that we are going to a triumph. I mean, it's not what we hoped, it's what we've seen in facts, because we were following facts, what happened. We finished that, we're ready for that. We tested all events, we have tested all the systems. So it must be good. It was not good. It was great. And of course, that meant a lot to Greeks that they were wanting, you know, of course, the success of the games. But for Greeks, it was also a way to show the world that they have to pay respect to them. And as I say, it was a way to be confident about ourselves. So that's why everybody was up to the task, and that's why everybody was really, I mean, enthusiastic. And of course, no, volunteerism is there. It worked. You know that we had to stop when we received more than 160,000 applications. And we told people, thank you very much, but we cannot get more, because we'll need only 45,000 volunteers for the Olympics and another 15,000 for Paralympics. So, I mean, we had to train them, to give them, to feed them, to give them their clothes and so on. And I mean, we had to be also very careful about our budget. Actually, we're the first organizing committee after Los Angeles that we had a surplus. We left in the government's cash 140 million euros, first time. So, I mean, the assets are there. As I told before, as I addressed before, I say that the leadership of the country has to look carefully what has been won up to now and take advantage of that and go towards the future with confidence, because we have gained a lot, and we have gained them by ourselves with our hard work and our belief that we can be better.
Thank you very much. I think you said it all. The Olympics were not good, they were great, and your leadership was not good, it was great. Thank you all very much. Have a safe evening to all the rest of you. Thank you.
You were an inspiration as well, you know, because I said, how can it be so unique, special and for not to be I wrote. Just as you wanted.